Hi everyone, welcome to our spring meeting. So today we have John Maindonald, who's going to talk about reproducible reporting using our data.
Bigger voice.
Sorry everyone, can you hear me now?
Nope.
So hopefully, I probably need a microphone. So today we have John Maindonald, who is going to talk about reproducible reporting using our markdown. And I know that John, you're going to do a demonstration in Shiny as well. So I hope all the technical setup will be fine for you. So we all know that John is semi-retired, but he's still very, very active in the R and statistics community. So he's doing some consulting work and still doing teaching and writing as well. So I'll just hand over to you, John. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much for the introduction. I'm glad to be back here and have the opportunity to make contact with some old friends and do this sort of thing by way of persuading myself that the brain cells haven't totally rusted. Our markdown, and I'll be working under our studio. This is exactly the title under which the meeting was advertised, but I kept on changing the title. But we're talking about a syntax that's in the tradition of NoWeb, the literate programming tradition. But the recent branch off that has been in the direction of reproducible reporting, the notion that one can have documents where you reproduce the from the original data the complete analysis and the steps by which that's incorporated into the final document. This has all sorts of applications. It has marvelous applications for keeping a record of work one has been doing. It has applications, of course, for publication, although that still has a long way to go in terms of incorporation into which into the actual publication practice. The technology is all there. It's just that not many people are using it. It's being used quite a bit for books. I'll comment about that later. Who's heard of NoWeb? One or two people. My description accurate?
You've heard of it.
You've heard of it, okay. It has a site on the web, and it's still fairly actively pursued, but I think that type of thing has gone much more in the direction of reproducible reporting rather than literate programming. Now, of course, the two interests merge to some extent. In R, there was something called, as an add-on to R, there's been for a long time something called S-Weave, which is LaTeX-based, and that involves has involved adding R code to LaTeX documents. You process the whole document to produce a final LaTeX document, which can then be run through PDF LaTeX or something like that to produce a final PDF file. That's been about for a long time. What I'm talking about tonight is a very much simplified version of that. Although you start very simply, you can add on virtually unlimited complication to it in ways that I'll explain in a moment. It's time to do a demo, I think. So, operating from within our studio, and I'll escape from this, and I'll go into our studio process, close that window. So here we are with our studio open. But what I'm going to do is to open, I'm going to get a file, I'm going to say new file, and I'm going to go to R Markdown. No, I'm not at this point, I'm going to go to R Presentation. And for my present purposes, I'm quite happy for the document to be called untitled.rpres, so I'll save that. And lo and behold, what I've got is a draft presentation document. So I can change the title to anything I like. Meet up our user group or something of that kind. And so on. Author JHM. Date, I can put in the 15th of October 2015. And I can run that document just as it stands by clicking on preview. Sorry, you may not be able to see that very text is rather small, isn't it?
No, no, it's good.
It's all right, is it? Okay. So I click on that, and in no time at all, because nothing much there, it produces an outline of the slides. Note what we have further down here. So here's a slide with code, three back ticks, and then a pair of curly brackets with R inside. You can put more inside if you want. Here is the R command. Cars is a data set that R, if it's not been changed from the default setup, we know about, and this will produce a summary, and then three backticks to close, and then a plot of the same data. So let's see what we've got over here. Here's the first slide, which I haven't changed. Here's the result with the R code and the output, that's the fourth action. And then here we have a slide with a plot. And I can click on here and say view in browser to get something that I can then, this is an HTML display actually, that I can then use by way of a presentation. So to do that, this works best in Chrome. As far as I'm aware, there's no... I meet up with 3E's, let me pass for the moment. View, I can go to enter presentation mode and we get a full screen presentation. And this is easily the easiest way that I know to prepare a presentation, you know, with or without R code in it. So I'll exit from that. Now, it's really, I'm quite happy for you to interrupt with queries if anybody would.
So the HTML file can be said, that's one single big file?
It has already been saved as one single big file. When I went to when I went here, clicked on there and said view in browser, I think everything is saved as a single big file. Certainly if I saved as a web page, that's what happens.
John, CARS is quite a complex data set, and a lot of these data sets like CARS and IRIS are there for people to play around with, to play around with their R code. It's got, from memory, 12 or 15 different variables for all of these different variables. And yet you asked a plot of CARS, but I would have thought you'd have to specify your X and your Y variables. I'm curious that you got one very specific plot when you just simply asked for a very general plot on that large data set.
No, the CARS data set in the R data sets package apparently has only two columns.
Well, I've used it many, many times to illustrate. It's got about 15.
Yes, there are various incarnations of
data sets. I think the CARS data set has
empty CARS.
What that looks like, it's a subset of empty CARS.
Fair enough.
Yeah, and there's another one in the RPART package too. They're all over the place. Different incarnations, different periods, different cars. If I want, if I don't want the code to be shown, I can say echo equals false. And this is what is called a chunk option. Down here for the plot, I might want to say control the figure height and the figure width. This is in inches. This changes it from the default. I think it's a fairly small figure if I do this. They don't seem to get scaled. And we can click on, let's fix up that link. And then I can click on preview and off we go. And again, view and browser and so on and so forth. It's produced a somewhat smaller pop. Now, an alternative, there's also something called a code notebook that I want to talk about. This is, let's get hold of an R code file. Yes. File I was looking for. We'll just work with that one. No, I won't. I'm going to go to. Yes, I will. So we'll go to code notebook. And here it is. Now, this is a. All you have here are, at first blush, comments and R code. But instead of having a straight comments symbol, which is perfectly okay, it'll just be interpreted as ordinary comments, I could put here from the R datasets package, something of that kind. That's just an ordinary comment, two hashes if you like. I can a quote symbol, a vertical quote, and that is all interpreted as text. That is using the R markdown syntax for inline code, so a back quote followed by whatever symbols one has there, followed by another back quote. What's there is just teletype text. And I've even sneaked in a bit of HTML, which I'm allowed to do. This will actually get converted into an R markdown file and then processed in the same way that all that previous display was being processed. I had meant before getting on to this to show you a regular R script file without these additions. I seem to have lost it. Oh, I found it. I'll show it to you in a moment. And you can put in the chunk options here in the same way that you put them into an R markdown file. And here is the plot command. All this stuff is documented in great detail on among the RStudio documents. So let's process that file through RStudio. You get a file and compile notebook. And off we go. And there you have it, which apart from my tinkering with the actual text, is pretty much the same thing that we had before.
And you can say that that's an HTML file as well?
That is an HTML file. And
on the background color is different.
Yes. You have control over all those things. I'm not really interested in going into the details. I'm simply trying to give you an indication of the sort of thing that is possible. So let's close that. And let's get this file that I couldn't find earlier. So this is taken from chapter 2 of my book with John Brown. Originally I was going to use the whole of chapter 2, but that created a rather long file. So this is just R code. And this is what happens if I process it to produce a code notebook. File, compile notebook, compile. Oh, and I've got control over whether the output is HTML or PDF. PDF relies on having a working version of LaTeX on your system. Or you can have it in Microsoft Word if you want. So I'll click on compile, and here we go. So by default, the code appears. Output by default is commented with two hash symbols on the far left, but I can change that or get rid of it. I don't like it actually, that's the way it's done. And the graphs appear as part of the file, and so on. And this is a great way to check that I haven't messed up any of my code, and make sure that the code is actually completely functional and does what I expected that it would do. And of course, if you're developing code, it's quite handy to be able to produce a code notebook and carefully annotate it with the date and other information and then put it away in your drawer for later reference. Okay. Any comments today? Questions?
So can you do this in our console? Or is this something which only really needs our studio?
No, all this stuff can be done in the R console. And you'll find among the documents that I will, which I'll give you a reference in a moment, details on how to do that.
Okay.
But for the purposes of this discussion here, obviously operating from the GUI is the way to keep things simple and fairly intelligible. So I want to open this file markdown.rpm. That's the one, right? Yes, right. So this is a presentation file. The only output available for this file this type of file directly, is HTML. You can of course print the HTML file to a PDF, but there's no direct provision if you go this rpres route for getting anything other than HTML. It's easy to adapt this file so that it's an RMD file that can be used to produce slides, and then you've got a choice of whether you get the output HTML or PDF or Word.
But all this HTML that produces static HTML, so there's no interactivity there.
I'll demonstrate interactivity a bit later.
Ooh.
Notice that I put a bit of R code in here to give you the date. Such things you can do, but the precise format in which you need to put it depends a bit on whether you're working with an rpres or an RMD file, and on what output you want. So let's process that. Again, the preview command, I don't have a preview is always going to produce HTML. Right. So let's click on more. Click on View in Browser. Click on View. Click on Enter Presentation Mode. And I've got one of the slides here. So the abilities are very wide-ranging. Markup languages are supported, and not just Markdown, but you can use markup within HTML, you can use markup within XML, and of course the ability to do this within LaTeX has been about for a long time. Tonight I'm focusing on Markdown, but just making you aware that it's what we do is almost infinitely extensible by slipping in HTML code. You asked about using the command line. You can also mix, of course, the graphical user interface with the command line. One can use the command line plus editor without RStudio. And for instance, for processing an RMD file, you can type in R Markdown, simply saying the render function is to be found in the Markdown package, :: render, and you give the name of the RMD file to be rendered. The strategy is, of course, to learn what's easy first. It may be all you need. Go on to something more complicated later if you need it. And so this is a great tool, I reckon, for introducing to students for use for their the submissions that you ask for from them. I used it to great effect. It was students doing the data mining course that I was involved in at Australian University, Western University. And of course, those students, and they'd pick it all up in 5 minutes, or pick up all they needed. I put a graph in that comes from my own CAD. I'll go back to that in a minute. Under the hood, what you have is the NetR package for R that was largely the work of Yi Hui Z. In my account as a friend, this particular package seemed to be a work of genius because he overnight it made huge advances on what was possible using SWE. There's the Markdown R package, which implements the PANDOC version of Markdown. There are all sorts of flavors of Markdown about. The originator refused to set down firm specifications, taking the attitude that it was up to the wider world to determine the forms in which it would find it use. It's quite widely used. For instance, I think WordPress pages, you can put in Markdown editing formatting. PANDOC, implemented in the PANDOC package for R, is used to convert between formats. That's an amazing piece of work. I wondered who this John McFarlane geek was. When I looked him up on the web, I discovered he was professor of philosophy at University of California, Berkeley, or one of the California universities, anyway. A good starting point is this document, which has links to documents that give more detail. If you want PDF output, as I said, you must have a TeX or LaTeX installation. But of course, you can print from a browser to a PDF file. Some further possibilities. You can include LaTeX style equations. This uses something called MathJax, so I guess that's another thing that's sitting there under the hood. You can sneak in HTML, and actually, if you're wanting output to PDF, you can carefully sneak in LaTeX, but the Markdown processing steps must not hide the LaTeX, so that's why I'm saying that it has to be done carefully. What else? Documentation is extensive. I brought along a few copies of a half page that has these details. For those, well, I think I've just got 10 copies. So, but this stuff you can rather easily find on the web just by going to our studio and looking for documentation. The documentation is very good and very extensive. So as much as anything else, I guess I'm trying to give you some clues about where to look. So let's go to View, Exit Presentation Mode. And let's go to, I was going to make some comments on what I've got here, right? So here's an example of a bit of R code that produces, that includes the time. This is introducing a list. Indent further and use plus signs and maybe other possibilities for a second level of list. Two underscores followed by the by text followed by two underscores gives you bold. It's enclosed within back quotes to identify it as R code or output from R code. If you actually want to do an R calculation here that produces some output, then you need to put in R as the first character. So here's the code that was used for that plot. Oh yes, the suggestion was that you want to keep a record of your energy usage in graphical form and update it from time to time. This is an easy way to do it. So what else have I got here? Single underscore, single star, followed by text, followed by single underscore, that gives you italic or emphasized code, emphasized text. This is automatically interpreted as a web address, and so on. There I've sneaked in a bit of HTML. That doesn't any longer, it's not any longer guaranteed to produce underlines, but in most of the browsers it does seem to.
Just a little question on that, John. Can you also introduce CSS into it as well?
Yes, you can.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a level of complication that I do not want to go into, yes.
Okay.
And that's the proper way to do these things. I didn't want to be fussed with CSS.
Right.
So, let's look at Shiny. Any comments, questions about anything else you'd like to see? I'm in good time, I think.
Are there any big companies and websites that are completely managed and produced by using this system or in the commercial arena? Is it an industry strength system to ask how to do?
Well, our studio is marketing this. Hadley Wickham, and in particular, has been giving addresses, I think, to large audiences up and down the United States. They're introducing people to this stuff. At this kind of level, this is all free. Our studio is a commercial organisation, but the packages are all part of the public license R, so anybody can use them quite freely. You can pay for additional services. You can pay an annual fee to our studio. Now for Shiny, which I'll talk about in a minute, which is in some sense is an extension of Markdown, I noticed that the fee is $10,000 a year, though they're prepared to negotiate lower amounts for smaller groups. There's a public domain, the public version, which allows you to run just one process at a time that's using our Shiny. In other words, doing the same kind of thing that I can do within an individual hour session here tonight. I think our studio is expecting large organisations to be making very extensive use of a lot of this stuff. They probably already are. Let's go to Shani. And actually, before I do that, maybe I'll show you how you can get started. We're going to file, new file. R Markdown, and then one of the options down here, because I have the Shiny package installed, is Shiny. So I can, let's have a Shiny presentation, because that will display better than an ordinary Shiny manuscript in this context. Click on OK. And I'm quite happy with the untitled title. It seems to know who I am. So now I can click on Run Presentation and just see what happens. Now notice that this is all automatically set up for you. This setup here and in Markdown generally is using what are called YAML conventions. YAML, I think, probably originally stood for yet another markup language, but it is now said to stand for not yet a markup language. Mm-hmm. So just one component that's been incorporated. And we've got runtime Shiny. That's just appeared automatically. I didn't put it. And here's a bit of setup. And here is the code. So let's run that and see what we get. And I'm quite happy to save it for that title. Here we go. Right, now let's go to open in browser, I think. Let's go to view, enter presentation mode. Yeah. This R Markdown presentation is made interactive using Shiny. The viewers of the presentation can change the assumptions underlying what's presented and see the results immediately. To learn more, go to this document on the web. So here we have it. I've got a slider here, and that is going to control the bandwidth, in other words, the smoothness of this fitted curve here, which is modeling the distribution. So if I move it down here, I get something that's increasingly jagged. Increasingly matches something close to the histogram. If I move this up here, I can get something that's very smooth. That's not allowing the data, I would say, to have its proper say, but you can control it. So where were we? Down about here, were we? Maybe about here. I can control the number of bins for the histogram. So if I want 10 bins, click there. I want 35 bins, click there, right? Any comment, question? And the rest of what's in this file is a standard markdown.
So all the processing done in RAM on the web browser?
All the processing, the processing is being done from within the R session from which I've run this. You have to have access to R in one way or another. Reason that our studio can charge for access to its souped-up web server is that that is the server that's going to run the processes that will support the displays that you're making available on the web or wherever.
And you're running this in Chrome. I take it it won't work with IE, or what's it like under Firefox?
It works under Firefox, but I can't get rid of the screen display at the top.
Okay.
There was no equivalent of the Chrome presentation mode.
Okay.
It's annoying because there's another purpose for which Firefox will do what I want and Chrome will not. Let's get a view exit presentation mode. You can run it also directly from this screen. So here's something I've done myself. Of course, Shiny Prez. This is done by just adapting that earlier document. No, it's the wrong one. Now, because this is not a presentation document, it's an RMD document. See, it has R&D at the end. I've got a bit more flexibility in what I can do. And there's a trick I can use here to put in my affiliation as well as my name. There's no direct provision for putting in my affiliation. This is the way I can do it. This is something that's, in some kind of rough sense, a Unix pipe. I don't understand why it works, but it does. One of those things that you discover by looking at Stack Overflow. And I've got a choice between an IO slides presentation and a sliding presentation. There's a slight problem with the sliding presentation, and that seems not yet to have been got to the point where it works completely effectively with with Shiny. This stuff is all under continuous development. I think some of this is quite new. So this is now telling you about Markdown with Shiny and giving you a web address to which to go. Now, I guess what I'd better do, let's look at the way the code is set up. So we have basically the user interface. This is the part of the code that's providing the user interface. One way to set up code for use on a server is to put a user interface file and a server file in some specified directory. I can show you that in mode of operation a little bit later if you want to see. Here, the code that's part of the user interface seems to be identified automatically. And so this is just concerned with setting up the slider. I'm calling the parameter lambda that's going to control the slider, and I want to have values between 0 and 1. I'll explain all this in a minute. This code here, which has been put inside the render plot function, is basically server code. And so that's the code that has to be directed to the server. And I'm doing some quite complicated coding in order to achieve some nice output. So let's do run the presentation. Open that in the browser. And now I'll go to view, enter presentation mode. Right. All good so far. Nothing. So first a few background details on the data I'm going to use. Some of you may have heard of this paper that appeared in PNAS, Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, claiming that hurricanes with female names were deadlier than hurricanes with male names because they were taken less seriously by the authorities. It caused a huge hoo-ha on the web. The university went to some pains to publicise it, and in a way, they asked for the flak they got. I'm working with a data set that's an updated version of what appeared in this controversial paper. It's an interesting data set with which to work for these present purposes. I'll show you why in a minute. So the variables that I have are damage that would have been caused by a similar storm in 2014, although Jugendamt had 2013 numbers. Base damage, which is damage at the time but inflation adjusted. Barometric pressure, which I'm not going to pay any attention to for present purposes, and a factor that codes F or M, depending on whether the hurricane had a male or a female name. Now, I think hurricanes were named, hurricanes of a certain magnitude were named from 1950 onwards, and from 1950 until about 1970, they all had female names, or mostly had female names, and then thereafter they alternated the names. You might want to think which makes more sense to use as an explanatory variable, the damage in 2014 or the base damage. It seems rather odd to think that hurricane in whatever year it occurred in 1950 would know what infrastructure was going to be about in 2014 to be destroyed. One of a big issue for this data, this is a simplification of possibilities. Doing a fairly simplistic kind of analysis, which is roughly equivalent to the one that the authors in that paper did, do we regress log deaths plus one on the log of the damage variable or on the damage variable itself? Or maybe we might do something in between. So here's the plot. And we've got deaths. I've used a log scale so that each interval is a factor of 10 multiplied. Well, it's log of deaths plus one, actually. And here, I've also used a log scale on the x-axis. And it's possible you might have a line going through the middle there. It's reasonably okay to me. On this particular topic, I'm not actually showing the line. Interesting, these three biggies, in terms of deaths that occurred before 1970, all had female names. Now, this is one extreme of a range of possibilities I want to consider. I'm just going to assume that we're working with a log scale for deaths, as the authors of that paper did. But what they did, as far as looking at the damage from the storm was concerned, was this. And they're basically assuming that one was going to put a line through that kind of data, albeit Katrina and Audrey were omitted because they were regarded as outliers. See, very, very odd. The author who did the analysis is actually, the final author who did the analysis is actually the author of a book on logistic regression. So I can also look at what is this value of lambda is a class of transformations that with lambda equal to zero gives you a log, with lambda equals one gives you no change at all. You basically it's basically the identity transformation. And in between, you get something in between a log transformation and the identity transformation. And so I can, what I'm able to do here is to experiment with various possibilities in between.
So is there a Box-Cox transformation?
We're talking about Box-Cox power transformations, yes, indeed. But I'm carefully avoiding using that term. But this seems to me to be, from a teaching point of view, a quite ideal way to introduce Box-Cox transformations. And of course, I could have done the same kind of thing on the y-axis. The other thing I could have done would be to allow interactive labelling. You know, click on a point and automatically gets labelled. So I can have several of these sliders, and I can have radio boxes and all sorts of things, radio buttons. Any comments, questions?
With the interactive plots, can you feed a live data stream into that?
Yes, I think so. Yes, there's no reason why not, because you can update the data. Yes. Actually, there are a large number of demonstrations on the web. How are we for time?
Good, yes.
Are you planning to finish at 10 to 7 or?
Up to you, John. I know that you've got lots of materials to go through.
Well, there's other stuff I can look at. Maybe I should show you some of that. So go to view and exit presentation mode. Now, down here in the directory where I have put, let's have a look what's in that directory. It's got two files, server.r and userinterface.r. So here's the server file. Again, it's working with the hurricane data. And here is the user interface file. now separate files. And in this mode of operation, I think I have to start with library shining up here. So what I can do is to go back to my R session and say run at now. I hope I've got this right. Help run at. Yeah. I think I'm okay then. So. Oh no, it's not there. It's library shining app, is it? Shining apps, that's what it is. Right. So myself the name of a shiny dash app one I've called it. So I'm going to run a shiny dash app one. Oh.
Library shiny.
Shiny, I didn't think I'd get quite this far. Just check if that's right. Right. So let's open that in the browser. This time, these windows, well, the slider and the graph itself has appeared side by side. Out of view, enter presentation mode, and I can play the same game as before. Okay.
Now, so it's running on the R server, running on that local PC you are working with.
That's right. Yes. So one needs, if you're going to put this up on the web page, one needs some equivalent access to an R process. There's a huge amount of stuff on the web. Let's have a look at. Help run app. And I think, oh, in fact, what happens if I just type in run app without putting an argument? No. Okay, so let's try help. Hopefully, it will tell me about the apps that are already there. No, it's not going to do that. Oh, yes, right, okay. One example. Okay, there's quite a choice. A histogram, tables and data frames, a reactive expression, global variables, slider bars, tab panels, help text and submit buttons, a shiny app built from HTML, a file upload wizard, a file download wizard, an automated timer. Which of these would you like to see? Well, let's just try tables and data frames, I suppose, to start. So here you can choose your data set, but you've given a choice of three data sets. So let's have a look at CARS data set. So that's what it looks like. And number of observations, you can control that. And it says, in this example, it's showing you the code down here. This example demonstrates output of new text. Maybe I should go so people can see it. Open the browser. That's better. And the code is shown down here. So these examples are quite nice to set up.
Like not interactive to the sense that you could edit on the web browser the sign UI file and server file?
In principle, there's no reason why not. But this is not doing that.
It's got a button there to show the app.
Sorry, where is that?
Bottom right.
Bottom right. Oh, show that. Right. Yeah, okay.
So you might be able to edit it.
Oh.
No.
That's simply controlling whether the code is shown or not. There's if you register with the RStudio people, you can upload your own Shiny apps to this RStudio site, and then they'll be available for all and sundry to work with.
Cool.
So I think unless there's other stuff that you'd like me to demonstrate, that's about it. But the way to get on top of this, I guess, is to you start experimenting yourself.
Hmm.
John, are there any questions
or anything that you would like John to demonstrate? I know that John has a lot of materials, so if there are any specific requests, this is the time. Any questions for John? Well, these notes that I've been using for courses I've run from time to time use the more traditional version, the LaTeX-based version of the R markdown kind of operation. So all this is done as reproducible documents in code. If I make changes to the code, I can immediately process the document through the netR package, produce a new LaTeX file, and then produce the PDF from that. And when I'm working on a fourth edition of this, I'm hoping to do that in the same style, which will help enormously for keeping stuff up to date. For my successor, or John Brown, to keep it up to date, if not me.
All right. Thank you very much, John. All right. So that is the end of today's meeting. James, should we aim for another meeting before Christmas?
Yep. Let's go for another meeting before Christmas.
Yep. I have two speakers in mind, so it should be easy to organize, hopefully, with the time it's working out for both of them. So, thank you very much for coming today, and let us know if there are any topics that you would like to hear. And
what are the prospective topics you're thinking about?
We've got Richard. Where's Richard? Richard was here before. Richard. Yes, yes. So Richard, my staff, Ethan, he's got something that he wants to present as well. So Richard's topic is really, really interesting. So Richard's going to talk about Games of Thrones. How do you call it? Sorry, I don't know anything about Games of Thrones. And Ethan's got some new stuff that he's developed that he would like to show. So I don't know what those are. He just talked to me yesterday. So we should certainly aim for another meetup before Christmas. If that works for you, Richard, and I'll chat with Ethan as well. Okay.
I'd just like to thank Harmonica Analytics for providing food and the drink again today.
Thanks, James, and thanks, Andy, for providing the menu and the technical setup. All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.